Just to follow up, because I thought I heard you say a moment ago that you had no communication with the president on the subject of Ukraine. Did I understand you to say that?
I have not particularly had any conversation with anyone on the subject of Ukraine that didn't deal with the matter that we have right now in regard to the whistleblower complaint. So not particularly with the Office of Legal Counsel as far as mentioning Ukraine, or as far as the Justice Department. All I did was send the documents forward. The allegations are in there, and you know, I just let the documents speak for themselves.
So you're saying that you did not have any conversation on the subject of Ukraine that did not involve this complaint?
That's correct, sir. I mean, I've been in the acting DNI for 6 weeks.
I'm just trying to understand, because that is suggestive that you did have a conversation involving the complaint with the president.
No. That is not what I said, sir.
Okay. Director, you mentioned early on when we were on the subject of what the Inspector General was able to investigate or not investigate, whether the president is within the intelligence community or subject to the intelligence community. And by the way, the statute doesn't require that the subject of the complaint be within the intelligence community. It requires the whistleblower to be an employee or detailee. It doesn't require that the subject, the person complained of, be an employee of the intelligence community. But you have adopted an interpretation by the Justice Department that essentially says the president is above the director, therefore the president is not subject to the jurisdiction of the director, therefore it doesn't meet the definition of urgent concern, therefore the Inspector General is done.
Chairman,
Inspector General can't investigate anymore. That's the Inspector General's reading of the department opinion, that he is no longer allowed to investigate this. Is that your reading as well?
Chairman, not necessarily the president, but the allegation has to relate to the funding, administration, and operation of an intelligence activity within the responsibility and the authority of the Director of National Intelligence.
Okay, well, I'm just trying to get to whether the president is somehow beyond the reach of the law.
No, sir, no person in this country is beyond the reach
of
the law.
Well, that's the way it should be, but I'm trying to figure out whether that's the way it is as a practical fact. The Inspector General believes that based on the opinion that you requested of the Department of Justice, he is no longer allowed to look into this because it doesn't meet the definition of an urgent concern because it involves the president. Is that your understanding of the department opinion as well, that the Inspector General no longer has jurisdiction to look into this?
It is my understanding that both the Inspector General and I and my team are waiting for, we were waiting for the resolution of executive privilege to be determined. It is now no longer executive privilege. I'm not sure exactly what the statute has as far as what Michael can do, but we also are looking for a way. Now, if I did not send it forward, as you know, under urgent concern within the 7 days, then the statute would allow the whistleblower to come to you and still be protected.
Director,
but because we are accommodating.
My point is this. The Department of Justice has said, because this doesn't meet the statutory definition, because this involves the president, the Inspector General has no jurisdiction to investigate. Now, if this Inspector General has no jurisdiction to investigate because the president is above the agency, no Inspector General has jurisdiction to investigate. That is the effect of that opinion. Which, do you disagree?
I believe that the opinion was based on the reading of the statute and whether or not the situation here is compliant and comes underneath the statute. The Office of Legal Counsel opinion was that based on the criteria that you're required to have in order to support this legal statute, it does not. And he also said that because of that, it is not a matter of the intelligence community. But once again,
yes,
he
well,
said,
that,
however, you may go forward, and
that's
I have.
That's the key issue, Director. Because it involves the president, It does not involve the intelligence community. That is the sum and substance. And the effect of that is the Inspector General has told us that he no longer has jurisdiction to investigate. And by the logic of that opinion, nor does any other Inspector General. Now, as you point out, this was referred to the Justice Department, it was referred to the FBI and Justice Department. That department, under Bill Barr, and with breathtaking speed, decided there's nothing to see here. It decided that we don't believe that this constitutes a violation of the campaign finance laws, and therefore, we're not authorizing an investigation. The FBI is not authorized to investigate any of this. Any of this. So the IGs can't do it. According to the Department of Justice, the FBI can't do it because it doesn't meet their threshold that makes it worthy of investigation. So at this point, only this committee and this Congress is in a position to investigate. And I want to ask you, going to the whistleblower complaint, whether you believe these allegations are worthy investigation. Whistleblower says, I have received information from multiple U.S. government officials that the President of the United States is using the power of his office to solicit interference from a foreign country in the 2020 U.S. election. You would agree that should be investigated, would you not?
Chairman, the horse has left the barn. You have all of the information. You have the whistleblower complaint. You have the letter from the ICIG. You have the Office of Legal Counsel opinion.
Yes, but
and you have
yes, we do. But would you agree that if there's a serious and credible
going to be an investigation,
that you agree there should be an investigation?
I believe that it is a matter to be determined by the chair and this committee.
Well, I'm asking you, as a career military officer, someone who I greatly respect and I admire your service to the country, do you believe if there is a credible allegation by a whistleblower, corroborated by apparently multiple U.S. government officials, that the President of the United States is using the power of his office to solicit interference from a foreign country in the 2020 election, do you believe that should be investigated?
I don't believe it was corroborated by other folks. The whistleblower says that he spoke or she spoke to about a dozen other people. This is secondhand information. I'm not criticizing the whistleblower.
Yes, but the Inspector General took those 2 weeks, as you well told us, to corroborate that information. Now, we don't know which, if any, of these officials the Inspector General spoke to and found it credible. And you've told us that you have no reason to believe otherwise. Am I right?
I had no reason to doubt a career Inspector General lawyer in his determination on whether or not it was credible. That is something for Michael to determine.
And let me ask you this. The whistleblower also says over the past 4 months, more than half a dozen U.S. officials informed me of various facts related to this effort to seek foreign interference. You would agree that we should speak to those half a dozen U.S. officials, would you not?
I think that you have all the material that the committee needs, and I think it's up to the committee how they think they need to proceed.
Well, I'm asking your opinion. As the head of our intelligence agencies, do you think that we should talk to those other people and find out whether the whistleblower is right?
My responsibility was to get you the whistleblower letter, the complaint, and the other information released. I have done my responsibility. That is on the shoulders of the legislative branch and this committee.
Well, let me ask you this, Director. The whistleblower also says, I am also concerned that these actions pose risks to U.S. national security and undermine the U.S. government's efforts to deter and counter foreign interference in U.S. elections. You would agree, if there's a credible allegation along those lines, that we should investigate it?
I agree that if there was an election interference, the complaint was not about election interference. It was about a classified, confidential, diplomatic conversation.
Involving election interference by the president, sought by the president. That doesn't take it out of the realm of seeking foreign assistance. It makes it all the more pernicious. Wouldn't you agree?
As I said, I don't disagree with the IGIC's assessment that it was a credible matter.
The whistleblower further says, namely, the president sought to pressure the Ukrainian leader to take actions to help the president's 2020 re-election bid. You would agree that that should be investigated?
Not necessarily, sir. I mean, as far as it was investigated by the Federal Bureau of Investigation.
No, it wasn't.
Yes, it went to the...
No, the Department of Justice concluded that this wouldn't violate the election laws. Now, no one can understand how they could reach that conclusion after the 2 years we've been through, but nonetheless, they didn't authorize the FBI to investigate it. You would agree someone should investigate this, wouldn't you?
I referred it, if I didn't, I would not have referred it to the Justice Department and to the FBI.
Well, then I'm glad that we're in agreement. The whistleblower says they told me that there was already discussion ongoing with White House lawyers about how to treat the call because of the likelihood in the official's retelling they had witnessed the president abuse his office for personal gain. You would agree that that should be investigated, wouldn't you?
All I know is that that's the allegation.
Right, sure. And it's credible and therefore should be investigated, right?
Well, it is hearsay, secondhand information. It should come to this committee for further investigation.
Thank you.
And I mean, you have it. You have the documents.
I just wanted to confirm that we're in agreement that you think the committee should investigate it. The whistleblower also says Donald Trump expressed his conviction that the new Ukrainian government will be able to quickly improve Ukraine's image and complete the investigation of corruption cases that have held back cooperation between Ukraine and the United States. This is the whistleblower citing the Ukrainian readout. You would agree that if the Ukrainian readout, when they're talking about corruption cases, is talking about investigating Biden and his son, and that has held back, the failure to do that has held back cooperation between our two countries, that should be investigated, right? That's of a national
Chairman
security
Schiff,
dimension.
I don't agree with any of that. What I did not agree that it should be investigated. What I said was that I complied with my requirement to send you the documents.
Well,
to this committee, and that it is up to the chair, ranking member, and this committee members to decide what to do with that information. I'm in no position to tell the chair or the committee to do an investigation or not do an investigation.
I find it remarkable that the Director of National Intelligence doesn't think credible allegations of someone seeking foreign assistance in a U.S. election should be investigated. Let me ask you this. The whistleblower further says, in the days following the phone call, I learned from multiple U.S. officials that senior White House officials had intervened to lock down all the records of the phone call. Do you have any reason to believe that the whistleblower's allegation there is incorrect?
I have no idea whether it is correct or incorrect, sir.
Someone should find out, though, right?
Excuse me?
Someone should find out if it's correct, shouldn't they?
I don't know if that is an incorrect allegation. I mean, I just do not know. Again, that is the work, that is the business of the executive branch of the White House and the office of the White House.
Well, corruption is not the business, or it shouldn't be, of the White House or anyone in it.
What the White House decides to do with their privileged communications and information, I believe, is the business of the White House.
Do you believe that's true even if that communication involves crime or fraud? I'm sure you're aware that there's an exception to any claim of privilege. The privilege can't be used to conceal crime or fraud.
As I said before, any crime or fraud or instances of wrongdoing should be referred to the Justice Department for investigation, as I did.
The whistleblower further alleges that White House officials told the whistleblower they were directed by White House lawyers to remove the electronic transcript, that is, of the call, from the computer system in which such transcripts are typically stored, and instead it was loaded into a separate electronic system that is otherwise used to store and handle classified information of a specially sensitive nature. One White House official described this act as an abuse of the electronic system. I do not know whether similar measures were taken to restrict access to other records of the call, such as contemporaneous handwritten notes taken by those who listened, and we should find out, shouldn't we?
Chairman Schiff, when I received a letter from Michael Atkinson on the 26th of August, he concurrently sent a letter to the Office of White House Counsel asking the White House Counsel to control and keep any information that pertained to that phone call on the 25th. It was a lengthy letter. Michael would be able to address it better. But I do believe that the ICIG, I know that the ICIG has sent a letter to the White House counsel requesting that they keep all of that information.
But you would agree that if there's a credible allegation from this credible whistleblower that White House officials were moving these records into a system that was not designed for that purpose in an effort to cover up essentially potential misconduct, that ought to be looked into. You would agree with that, wouldn't you?
To the best of my knowledge, when this allegation came forward, this whistleblower complaint, on the 12th of August, I have no idea what the timeline was as far as whether or not the White House, the National Security Council, or anybody involved in that conversation, what they did with the transcripts, where they put them. I just have absolutely no knowledge, nor the timeline of that, Chairman. It is not something that would be under my authority or responsibility.
The whistleblower makes a series of allegations involving Mr. Giuliani, cites a report in the New York Times about his planned trip to Ukraine to press the Ukrainian government to pursue investigations that would help the president in his 2020 re-election bid. You would agree that if the president was instructing his personal lawyer to seek, again, foreign help in a U.S. presidential election, that that would be improper? I believe Mueller described such efforts to seek foreign assistance as unethical, unpatriotic, and very possibly criminal. Would you agree with Director Mueller that to seek foreign assistance that way would be unethical, unpatriotic, and very possibly a violation of law?
I believe that Mr. Giuliani is the president's personal lawyer. And whatever conversation that the president has with his personal lawyer, I would imagine would be by client attorney privilege. I am in no position to criticize the president of the United States on how he wants to conduct that, and I have no knowing of what Mr. Giuliani does or does not do.
Let me ask you about the last couple allegations of the whistleblower. I learned from U.S. officials that on or around 14 May, the president instructed Vice President Pence to cancel his planned travel to Ukraine to attend President Zelensky's inauguration on 20 May. Secretary of Energy Rick Perry led the delegation instead. According to these officials, it was also made clear to them that the president did not want to meet with Mr. Zelensky until he saw how Zelensky, quote, chose to act, unquote, in office. I do not know how this guidance was communicated or by whom. I also do not know whether this action was connected with the broader understanding described in the unclassified letter that a meeting or phone call with the president and President Zelensky would depend on whether Zelensky showed the willingness to play ball. Do you know whether Mr. Pence, Vice President Pence's trip, was pulled because of an effort to find out first whether Ukraine was willing to play ball?
Chairman Schiff, no, I do not. I have no knowledge of any of that until this information came to me from the ICIG. I have absolutely no situation awareness or no knowledge of any of those facts.
Would you agree that if the Vice President's trip was canceled in order to put further pressure on Ukraine to manufacture dirt on Mr. Biden, that that would be unethical, unpatriotic, and potentially a crime?
I do not know why the Vice President of the United States did not do that. I do know what the allegation was within the whistleblower complaint, and I don't know whether that allegation is accurate or not, Mr. Chairman.
Finally, the whistleblower says, on July 18, an Office of Management and Budget official informed departments and agencies that the President earlier that month had issued instructions to suspend all U.S. security assistance to Ukraine. Neither OMB nor the NSC staff knew why this instruction had been issued. Senator McConnell said the other day that he spoke with the Secretary of Defense and Secretary of State, and he didn't know why the instruction had been given. Doesn't that strike you as suspicious, Director, that no one on the national security staff, no one in the senior leadership, apparently, of the party here in Congress that had approved the aid, understood why the president was suspending aid? Doesn't that strike you as just a little suspicious?
Chairman Schiff, I'm just unaware, be honest with you, how those decisions are made. And once again, I just have no situation awareness of what happened with the holding of the funding from OMB.
As a military man, if this military aid was withheld from an ally that is fighting off Putin's Russia, and it was done so to be used as leverage to get dirt in a U.S. political campaign, don't you think that should be investigated?
I have no reason to believe, I do not understand, I have no situational awareness if that was withheld or why it was withheld, Mr. Chairman.
Well, I can tell you, we are going to find out. Director, I want to thank you for your attendance today. I want to thank you again for your service. As my colleague underscored, Mr. Welch, and I completely share his sentiment, no one has any question about your devotion to the country. No one has any question about your acting in good faith. I want to make that very clear. I think you're a good and honorable man. Like my colleagues, I don't agree with the decisions you made. I agree with the Inspector General's view of the law. And I'm deeply concerned about the message this has sent to other whistleblowers about whether this system really works. If the subject of a complaint can stop that complaint from getting to Congress, then the most serious complaints may never get here. And I want to thank the whistleblower for their courage. They didn't have to step forward. Indeed, we know from the whistleblower complaint, there are several others that have knowledge of many of the same events. And I would just say to those several others that have knowledge of those events, I hope that they too would show the same kind of courage and patriotism that this whistleblower has shown. We are dependent on people of good faith to step forward when they see evidence of wrongdoing. The system won't work otherwise, and I have to say to our friends in Ukraine who may be watching, just how distressing it is that as their country fights to liberate itself from Russian oppression, as it fights to root out corruption in their own country, that what they would be treated to by the President of the United States would be the highest form of corruption in this country. That the President of the United States would be, instead of a champion of democracy and human rights and the rule of law, would instead be reinforcing a message with the new Ukrainian president who was elected to root out corruption, that instead the message to that president would be, you can use your Justice Department, just call Bill Barr, you can use our Justice Department to manufacture dirt on an opponent. That's what democracy is. You can use foreign assistance, military assistance, vital assistance as a lever to get another country to do something unethical. The idea that a fellow democracy, a struggling democracy, would hear those messages from the President of the United States. I just want to say to the people of Ukraine, we support you in your fight with Russia. We support you in your struggle for democracy. We support you in your efforts to root out corruption. And what you are witnessing and what you are seeing in the actions of this president is not democracy. It is the very negation of democracy. This is democracy. What you saw in this committee is democracy, as ugly as it can be, as personal as it can be, as infuriating as it can be. This is democracy. This is democracy. I thank you, Director. We are adjourned.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.